For over a month, the United Nations has been sounding the alarm about the growing food crisis in Zimbabwe. It's estimated that 60% of the population does not have access to adequate food. We'll talk with people with deep understanding of the situation, but first, we have this background report.
In what used to be called Southern Africa's breadbasket, today Zimbabweans are desperate for food. Facing a climate disaster and an unprecedented economic meltdown, more than half of the population is food insecure. The United Nations World Food Program is sounding the alarm.
We are facing the worst hunger crisis in more than a decade. The situation is nothing short of tragic. There's no other way of putting it.
Zimbabwe is enduring its worst drought in decades. And for rural farmers, largely growing water-intensive maize, erratic rain patterns have proven catastrophic. In Hwange National Park, herds of elephants died of drought-related starvation earlier this year. But the crisis is largely man-made, according to the WFP.
The crisis is being exacerbated by a dire shortage of foreign currency, runaway inflation, mounting unemployment, lack of fuel, prolonged power outages, and large-scale livestock losses. And they inflict the urban population just as well as rural villages.
The International Monetary Fund says Zimbabwe's inflation rate is the world's highest at 300%. Many blame the political and economic turmoil on former President Robert Mugabe. The anti-colonial icon was at the forefront of Zimbabwe's independence in 1980, but he clung to power for nearly 30 years, presiding over the decline of what was once one of the continent's most prosperous countries. He was ousted in 2017. Hope that Mugabe's successor, President Emmerson Mnangagwa, can reverse the decline is running thin. The government is now scrapping a plan to remove grain subsidies next year, a move aimed at shielding Zimbabweans from the rising food costs.
For more on all of this, we turn to two men who know Zimbabwe well. Gerry Bourke is the Southern Africa spokesman for the United Nations World Food Program, the lead international agency working to alleviate the food crisis in Zimbabwe. He was just there last week. And Harry Thomas Jr. had a 34-year career as an American diplomat and served as the U.S. ambassador to Zimbabwe from 2016 to 2018. And welcome to you both. Thank you for being here. Gerry, I do want to begin with you. 60% of the country's 14 million don't have the food to meet their basic needs. You were just there. Tell me what you saw and heard from families on the ground.
Well, it's really a national catastrophe, a calamity. People simply do not have enough food. The larders are dry. The harvest comes in once a year in April. Stocks from that are largely exhausted. They're looking forward to the next harvest in April. The rainy season has arrived. It's arrived two months late. There are patches of green, but the lack of rain is really causing problems. Seeds put into the ground have not germinated. Some replanting will have to be done. And in the meantime, people are struggling to get by in a major way, taking kids out of school, selling off precious belongings, selling off cattle, for example. Lots of people really hurting.
Gerry, give me a specific example, if you can, of the kinds of things people are telling you. What, for example, is an average family eating and subsisting on day to day?
Well, they're eating less. They're skipping meals. A little bit of maize meal, but prices have skyrocketed. A loaf of bread is now 20 times what it was 6 months ago. Maize, the staple food, has increased multiple times. So it's a huge struggle just to get by.
Ambassador Thomas, you heard Gerry mention the rainy season coming late. There has been a drought. There's a broader climate crisis in the region. This isn't just due to drought, though, is it?
No. The people of Zimbabwe deserve better. This is because of massive corruption, mismanagement for many years. The government and leaders of Zimbabwe are only interested in power accumulation and wealth maintenance. It's unfortunate. It's man-made, despite the drought, as Gerry said. We're very pleased, however, that the United States has stepped up, has already put about $170 million toward food security. The British and the European Union have as well. But the people of Zimbabwe deserve better.
that mismanagement, that corruption you mentioned, it's sort of alarming for people to think about how a country can go from being the continent's breadbasket, as we said in the report, to this downward spiral where people are struggling for basic needs. How does that happen so quickly?
It happens when its leaders take all of the money that they earn through selling minerals, as they should, gold, plutonium, they are a very wealthy country, and put it in their pockets. And you have to think, they had over 1,300 dams. They're not longer maintained. The wells are no longer maintained. People are digging boreholes to get water, and that puts makes they keep digging deeper and deeper, and there's less water, and this is exacerbated by the drought and climate change.
Gerry, you mentioned some of those hard choices that people on the ground are having to make. We're focused on the food crisis because that's often one of the most visible among the crises, but Zimbabweans are dealing with so much more. Tell me about some of the ripple effects you're worried about this crisis could have.
Well, we're very focused on scaling up ourselves. We're going to double within the next few weeks the number of Zimbabweans we are supporting, those in crisis and emergency levels of food insecurity. So we're going from about 2 million people now to over 4 million. And we'll be doing that through the peak of the lean season, which is essentially January to March, ahead of the next harvest in April. So a major scale up requiring all hands to the pump and a significant amount of money if we are to fully affect that scale up.
And Gerry, I was reading the previous World Food Program work there has been largely cash assistance going into Zimbabwe. That's no longer the case, though, is it? Tell me what's happening on the ground now.
In fact, what with hyperinflation and very limited availability of local currency, we are having to do a wholesale switch from cash assistance to in-kind food assistance. So we are, and because much of the rest of Africa has also suffered from drought and flooding, we are having to source the food for Zimbabwe much further afield, in Latin America, in Asia, and in Europe. Some in Africa, but most of it from elsewhere. So it's a massive, old-fashioned logistical operation, shipping food into Durban in South Africa, in Beira in Mozambique, and then trucking the food into landlocked Zimbabwe.
You know, Ambassador Thomas, you mentioned all the U.S. money going into Zimbabwe, and you also mentioned that corruption was part of the problem that got people there where they are today. Is there any concern that continuing corruption could mean that people of Zimbabwe don't get the help they need?
Yes, there is. That is our concern, our government's concern, and it should be, but we need to hold the government accountable. For example, they've imported wheat from Tanzania. The worldwide price is about $240 to $250 a ton. They charge $600. So they've inflated the price so the wealthy and the cronies can buy it and sell it at a price over double the worldwide price. They're trying to import some from Mozambique, as Gerry said, but Mozambique wants to be paid in hard currency. This is another African nation that's saying, you pay me in hard currency, and the people will suffer. And these are brilliant people. I don't know if you know. I was there for 3 years. This time they had six Rhodes Scholars. They always have Rhodes Scholars every year. I'm sure they'll have more. And to see people have not to send their kids to school, to have to walk to work, not to have the ability to get secondary education is heart-rending.
We have less than 30 seconds left, and I have to ask you a big question. With all this aid, is there a hope that things will get better for the people of Zimbabwe?
Well, I have confidence in the U.S. government, our European colleagues, the U.N. agencies who are stepping up to the plate to help the people of Zimbabwe. What we need to do is have the government of Zimbabwe be transparent. They have grains in their storage. Tell us how much they have so we can help them.
Be transparent and be accountable.
Yes.
Ambassador Harry Thomas and, of course, Gerry Bourke from the World Food Program. Thanks very much to both of you.